Expose the largest amount of area to sunlight, and in order to do that, the geometry is exactly the opposite. It's
some questions. You know, how do we do astrophysics in the lab on this Earth? Is that somebody puts a telescope and keeps looking, right? Keeps waiting. It's like a spy game. I'm told that spying, you know, watching somebody, catching them doing something wrong, is a very serious business, and it gets paid a lot simply because the guy goes and parks himself in a car and is watching who is going into the building, who is going away from the building, what happened when, and after a lot of search he finds that, yeah, this is the killer. You know, he was found on that day and I trapped him. So pretty much like what we do in astrophysics, we have a telescope somewhere on the Earth, and these days we actually go into the space, right? We launch telescopes into space, and we are trying to wait for something to happen somewhere. Things are happening all the time, but maybe your eye is not open, your telescope is not looking there. So we try and put as many telescopes in as many directions and as many wavelengths and keep watching and wait for the universe to reveal itself to us. And this is something that I tease all my friends, and of course you can get beaten up for this, saying that we are told that never live in the past. Right? Have you all been told, don't live in the past, move on? But this is one subject where you are always living in the past. Maybe.
No, so you take the, so you look at the stellar brightness. So of course it will have some fluctuation. But then you can see that there is some average brightness. Right? So for example, you look at here. So you look at some average brightness. So this you define as 1. So then you look at how much dip it is. Obviously this is some variation, yes. But you fix any particular, that doesn't matter. You fix this as 1, right? You fix this as 1. So then you divide everything by that.
So we have this.
I am going to ablate this sphere, and once the top layer is ablated, there will be a shock wave, there will be a recoil that happens, and the inner layers actually get compressed tremendously. Inner layers of the shell, right? The outer layer gets blown off by laser ablation, and as a rocket model, there is this rocket model, so there is a reaction force which actually compresses the matter, and compresses and heats.
So you mean the implosion technique?
Implosion. So there's an implosion that happens, and the implosion raises the density and also raises the temperature, and hopefully, but there's a host of plasma instabilities because of which this hasn't happened. But we are trying to still make variations.
The point of this is essentially that, say, very fundamental questions about space we live in. Yeah. What happens is that, say some massive object, say for example chair, table, some individual, and this space, they look very different. Yeah? Somebody conceptually puts them in the same framework. from one point of view, if you want to understand things, then there's some framework which unifies all this. These are fundamental theoretical advances. Okay, why did I bring up relativity? So, the framework that puts all this stuff together is called general relativity. Mass and space-time put on the same footing. What is the footing? The footing is determined by Einstein's equations, essentially determine the geometry of space-time. The mass distribution determines the geometry of space-time. Okay, very good. How did he come up with that? What is the mathematics underlying it? And when was that discovered? That mathematics was discovered by somebody called Riemann in the 1840s or 50s. 60 years before Einstein came up with this. He had some friend who taught him all this Riemannian geometry, and then he realized that, okay, so this is the real tool which captures as a formal object a way of looking at space-time and matter, which composes you, this table, me, this computer, everything. All of that in one unified framework, one simple equation. Thing is, if you, whether you want to do physics or maths, if this kind of phenomenon excites you, then you better do it. If that does not elicit wonder, then don't do either mathematics or physics.
Handle such numbers on computer. Why? Because these diverge as you go to zero and stuff. So something singularities are like physical singularities that are like they cannot be handled at all on a computer at least. One cannot handle them analytically itself. So on computer, that's so.